Look, thank you, Jane, for the introduction, and thank you for inviting me to speak at the conference. It's a pleasure and an honour to be here. And I will say, actually, just one thing, can I thank you, especially for kind of getting my name right, because I've had MCs kind of not do it quite so well with such aplomb, and because apparently my name's quite a difficult one to get your tongue around sometimes, and I'm just remembering about a year ago, a guy who was a professional MC, and he got up on stage, and he was running the conference about 3 days, and I was the last speaker, and he jumped up on stage, and he said, "Ladies and gentlemen, we've got our final speaker now, and he's done this, and he's done that," and he was bouncing off the walls, this guy. He was quite impressive, and everyone was getting pretty excited. I was sitting on the edge of my seat myself, you know, thinking, far out, who's next? And then he said, "Ladies and gentlemen, would you please put your hands together for Rob Waddell?" Now, I don't know if you've met Rob Waddell before, but he's 6'8" tall, a couple of axe handles wide, 340 kilos, give or take 100. He is a very impressive, imposing fellow. So you can imagine how disappointed people were when I got on stage. And, you know, all I can say to that is, it's not what you're given that matters, it's what you do with it that counts, isn't it? And, you know, I kind of stick with that philosophy, and I think it's not a bad one to, at times of under duress. And, look, I'm not going to... I said, Emma, what would you like me to talk about? And she said, "Look, Rob, you just talk about whatever you want to talk about." So, oh, that's pretty cool, actually. I've got open slather here, so I'm just going to talk about what I feel like talking about. I was born in 1960. Anyway, no, I won't go there. But I will say, I will... Yeah, we will row the Atlantic together, we'll pay a visit to Cambodia, we'll check out Mount Everest and maybe a quick peek at the South Pole along the way with other stuff. But I will begin by saying a basic sort of mantra I have is life is an adventure. Life is an adventure. And if we can treat life as such, I think it will help us get through the challenging times. And we all have challenging times in our lives. And I love this photo because it epitomises a whole bunch of things if you really look into it. It's the adventure, it's the person who's going out on a limb, going out on the edge of the world and is on a path of discovery. And life is about discovery. He's travelling really light and he's being really efficient in his travels. And and you know what? He doesn't really know what's around the corner, but he's prepared for the worst, hoping for the best, of course. Avoiding the precipice, staying on the path as best as possible, and I kind of, as I say, I think if you can treat life as an adventure through the challenging times, I think, you know, that, I don't know who said it, some guy said, you know, this too shall pass. It's another one that I kind of stick to through those difficult times. But also, if you think life is an adventure when you have the good things, you go, yes, wasn't that a great adventure? We've got through that. That was fantastic. And it's, I think you've got to celebrate the successes along the way. I guess my other thing is I do believe with passion, anything is possible. And also with passion, not only with passion, but with belief. With passion and belief, anything's possible. And I became very passionate about a project, I suppose, I heard about when I was competing at the Olympic Games, part of the New Zealand rowing team, turned up at the Atlanta Games. And while we were there, I saw a notice that it was on a flyer on a notice board, and it said Atlantic Rowing Race. And this thing kind of caught my eye. And I thought, well, this is interesting. I read up about this concept for two-person boats. Boats crewed by two people were to row across the Atlantic Ocean from Tenerife, which is in the Canary Islands, just off the northwest coast of Africa. And it was to traverse the Atlantic Ocean across to Barbados in the West Indies. And I thought, mate, got to have a crack at this. Made a decision to have a crack at this thing. First ever rowing race across an ocean for rowing boats. You beauty. Now, 4,000, about 3,000 miles, roughly 4,500 miles of open ocean. Now, I discovered, actually, that's quite a long way. And tell you, couldn't get my head around it, quite frankly. After I'd made that decision, have you ever been out to a star, into the starry nights? Have you ever really looked into the heavens and tried to imagine the enormity of the universe? Have you ever done that? I have, and you're just about fall unconscious, because you can't, really. And I kind of I kind of tried to get my head around this thing at that time, and I really was in a state of flux because I couldn't, quite frankly, until I saw, something's happened with the presentation. That's right. I'll tell you about a crew that had actually attempted to row an ocean before this. Now, this was the first ever rowing race across an ocean, but there had been previous attempts to row oceans in the last 100 years prior to that first race. And of those, about a third had survived, about a third had been rescued in various forms of disrepair, and the remainder had been lost at sea. And this guy here, Andrew Halsey, was one of those guys who was recovered, rescued.
Well, good morning. This is now, I've been out here 60 days and pretty much gone through everything negative.
Negative, right? I actually became quite depressed at sea.
I don't know what to do anymore. I am just out and out beat.
He also started to imagine things.
And the other thing is that shark out there that's following me every day, just smiling away, thinking, is today the day I'm going to get my bloody dinner? Well, he ain't having me yet.
Andrew actually ran out of food at sea, and he spent 60 days at sea with no food, and this is the result.
The resupply has not shown up. I've lost a lot of weight, and this is it. It's the end of the day.
He thought his number was up when he took that video, and he was obviously relying on being rescued, and he was. And would you believe, a year later, Andrew got back in a boat and attempted to row an ocean again. Hey? Had to be rescued again. But, you know, I do believe he's in the planning process of trying to have another crack at it. You know, we all fall over, don't we? We all make mistakes. And as long as you get back up again and keep going, you'll get there in the end, I believe. Here's an example of that. Just watch this. Look at that. Isn't that inspiring? He got back up again. Hope this guy got back up again. So another guy got a bit of a cut on the top of his foot, abscessed, tried to row an ocean. Look away if you've got a bit queasy mind. He actually got gangrene in all the toes of his feet, had all the toes amputated as a result of his misadventure. So it had all the makings of a reasonable sort of challenge, as I say, and I came back to New Zealand. I found out to be part of this race, I had to buy a kit set boat off the organisers. And this was a slab of plywood, basically 23 sheets of plywood. Each sheet was 8mm thick, pre-cut kit set design, and it was assembled like a jigsaw puzzle. And you stamp this thing out and stick it together, and this is the first stage of construction of that boat. Stage two, thus 7 metres long, about 21 feet long, 22 feet long, 6 feet wide, crewed by two people. Now, had this kit been flown over from the UK, I still had to find somebody out there a couple of egg whites short of a PAV to join me. And quite frankly, I'd been to my Olympic teammates, Rob Bedell being one of them at the Olympics, and saying, mate, have you seen this amazing concept? Imagine rowing this enormous puddle. Wouldn't it be an amazing adventure and challenge and race? Fantastic. And nobody was the slightest mention. Seriously, and I couldn't believe it. So I went to the media, and a few people got in contact, and one guy came out of the woodwork, Phil Stubbs, literally in this photo, as the perfect teammate for the job. Tough as boots. Committed, determined, and Phil had he was a coast to coast athlete, an Ironman triathlete, a surf boat rower as well. Phil had all those physical capacities as a teammate to join me in this great adventure. But the big thing that sold me on Phil was the fact that he had sea experience as well, which I figured was reasonably important. I'd never been to sea before in my life, and I needed someone to cover for my weaknesses, which were many and varied. And this is a gorilla picking flowers. So we got to the start. Sorry, family photos. We got to the start. 30 boats lined up for the adventure of a lifetime. Sunday morning, 10 o'clock in the morning. Away we go.
This is it. After 2 years of preparations, the 29 teams are ready to start in flat, calm, ideal conditions. Ahead lies 3,000 miles of Atlantic Ocean, and all they can use to get across in their home-built craft is muscle power and determination.
Well, when we first put the project together, we anticipated something like about five entries, so that when we eventually ended up with all these boats at the start line, 30 boats, it was absolutely tremendous and very exciting to see them all in their different colours, and some had flags flying, absolutely wonderful, really very, very exciting.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Tell you, every time I see that, I'm just right there with them. And I don't know if you could be there too, but imagine sitting in that boat, pointing the bow out into the big old, you know, big old blue, the unknown, and just going for it. It was just the most extraordinary feeling. And even more extraordinary was the fact that we just rode through the fleet. We absolutely dusted the crews out of the blocks. Not that we're doing anything extraordinary, but it was just amazing. And we had a couple of basic core strategies. If we were going to win this race, and we were going there to win, we didn't want to just make up the numbers, was to keep the boat light, because light boats, fast boats, like that person carrying a very light backpack, you know, light and fast and efficient. And everything we did in the building the boat, don't take too much food with us, don't take too much equipment. You know that plywood shell I showed you earlier? The fleet added layers of fiberglass sheathing over the hull. As an example, we just slapped a coat of paint on ours, mate. She'll be right. Light boats, fast boats. Very important. Very important. About day two, I'll just go back a slide. As we were literally watching the boats disappear over the horizon behind us, we were feeling fantastic. And I should say it was an extraordinary feeling. After about 18 months working on the campaign full time, finally it was happening. And until we turned on our water maker, we were feeling pretty cool. And this water maker wouldn't go. For the first time we tried to use it in this race, converted salt water from fresh water to fresh water. Very important piece of equipment. Wouldn't go. Later on that night, the first night, the seas got rougher and rougher. It was fantastic, actually, because we ended up surfing waves, and it was exhilarating, it was exciting, fantastic. But about 2 o'clock in the morning, I was up on the oars in the bow seat there, Phil's in the cabin having a breather, and a particularly nasty wave broke into the side of the boat, lifted the boat up on its side, and we very nearly capsized. In the process, an oar went under the boat, washed over the oar, snapped it in two, nearly got thrown overboard at the same time. Everything seemed to be going wrong in the first 24 hours. The water maker's gone down, I was seasick, nearly thrown overboard, nearly capsized the boat, broken an oar, couldn't sleep during my rest time, had another chunder. I was feeling pretty average, to be fair. And we had several strategies. One was to keep the boat light, another one was to keep going. If you can't walk, creep. Just keep inching towards the destination. And I think you can apply that philosophy to anything in life. And we did that by doing two-hour shifts, where one person would row and one would rest, turn and turn about. So it was 2 hours on, 2 hours off, 2 hours on, 2 hours off, round the clock, non-stop, non-stop. And we felt if we could maintain that, based on what we'd seen out of the blocks, we thought, mate, we're going to be hard to beat. And we did back ourselves, you know. But that was still a pretty tough start to the campaign. One of the other entries in the race that didn't have such a good time. I love this boat here. The best looking boat in the fleet, actually. Actually, no, I'll talk about this one. This Way Up. It's quite an appropriate name for a boat, I think. This Way Up. Interesting guy. That guy, they rowed for about 4 hours, 5 hours, and the skipper discovered he had a phobia of the sea. Seriously. Turned the boat around, rowed back into shore, packed the boat up and went home. This beautiful boat here, best looking boat in the fleet. The problem was it was a husband and wife entry. Yeah, there are a few sparks at sea, and this was the result. And yes, they had a bit of a barney apparently, and they decided we're bailing out of here, got rescued. The boat had to be set alight because it was a sea hazard. Just a tragedy, really, when you think about the campaign preparation. Problems we had, contact points, blisters, calluses, and what have you, and it got to the point where you developed a kind of an arthritis as well, and it got to, we actually developed pizza hands. These were not our hands, actually, as one of our physicians, but it didn't get quite that bad. We also developed, well, you know the other contact point? It's your hands when you're rowing? Your butt, yeah. And we developed, you guessed it, pizza bum as well. Would you like to? No? Just one yes? Yes, thank you. Check this, this is horrendous. And that's a horrendously bad joke. Anyway, mid-Atlantic we discovered we're getting algae and barnacles on the bottom of the hull slowing us down. Had to be removed, of course. I love these photos. That's that's Phil there, bubbles coming out of his nose. Great shot. This here's Phil again, scrubbing away. That's Phil's feet. There's no photos there of me. primarily because I was too kind of, chicken. Get out of the boat. And I did try, and I looked over the side, you know. It's flaming deep. It's over here. You can't. Flaming. And that's not the only thing that concerned me either. It was those things, of course. And so, I just imagine if we both got in there, this was going to be the scene, eh? Right behind us. So I volunteered to go on Shark Watch, and Phil did the job. Beautiful, deep blue ocean. Absolutely stunning.
So while Phil works on the boat, Rob surveys the scene. Flat calm. No munchies.
Yeah, it was like Lake Taupo for about a week. It wasn't like that all the time. Day 40. Been at sea for 40 days, and we had just 70 miles to go to Barbados. And we saw the square rigger here out on the horizon. And these guys started talking to Phil on our VHF radio. Now, VHF is line of sight. If you can see somebody, you should be able to communicate using this piece of equipment. This is a remote pointer. It's not a VHF, but I'm just saying. We did not have any satellite phone on board the boat. We chose before the race to keep the boat light, not to take sat phone communications, as most crews did. There's about another 20 kilos of the equipment, another 40 kilos of batteries and what have you. So we chose not to. The problem with that was we were totally isolated at sea, one of the more difficult things to cope with. And as a result of that, we didn't know whether we were winning or losing the race. We hoped we would be, of course, and we thought we might be based on what we'd seen out of the blocks, being so much quicker. And we'd stuck with our two on, two off around the clock. We just didn't know, and we're dying to find out. Kiwi Challenge, welcome to Barbados. It's great to see you. Been following your progress on the internet and all the other boats and some wonderful stories coming off from some of the other boats and blah, blah, yakety. This guy went on. I said, Phil, mate, break in, find out how the heck we're going, for goodness sake. And he finally managed to get a word. He said, yeah, great to see you guys too, but look, could you tell us what our position is over? Yeah, you're 13 degrees north and 20 degrees west or whatever it was. Yeah, thanks for that. But look, could you tell us what our position in the race is? Are we first? Are we 10th? How are we going? Over. And they said, Kiwi Challenge, you are number one. You are number one. Imagine that 40 days and hearing those words. Mate, it's just incredible. We hooted and yelled and high-fived, and I nearly fell overboard. You know, it was mayhem. And it was a good handshake, eh? There was no hugs. And it was all good stuff. But I was just, you know, beside myself. And then Phil says, mate, calm down. He says, Hamill, calm down. We've got a good 70 miles to go here yet. We do not want to be overtaken on the last hurdle, so to speak. So, flaming good call, Stubbs, ever the pragmatist old Philly. That's fantastic news, fellas, but look, could you tell us how far back the next boat is over? Yeah, 560 miles. So we took a two-minute break, and we got back on the oars again, and coming into that finish was just fantastic. Thank you. pretty cool. Pretty happy to be on dry land. Worst thing I could have done was have a swig of the champagne. physically speaking, for what we've been through, relatively good condition though, although lost a lot of weight. Phil lost 8 kilos, I lost 14 kilograms. It's about 32 pound of butter, I suppose, if you stack it up. the second crew in were the French. Interesting story, this guy here, in the foreground, was a convicted murderer. Killed 2 people in a bar fight, spent 14 years in prison. Day he got out of prison, flew down to Tenerife, jumped in a boat, rowed across the Atlantic Ocean, came second in the first ever rowing race. His partner was his parole officer. Just keeping an eye on him. Great story. Now, one of the things I was going to talk about, actually, Tim, I'm just conscious of the time. That course, generally the idea was to head southwest out of the blocks. Going straight across wasn't necessarily the quickest route to take. Southwest was kind of the way, and interesting story, one of the other crews told me, actually about a year afterwards I caught up with him, and he said, you know, we were rowing along one day, and I came out for my shift, and said, I reckon we need to head a bit more west, you know, heading a bit too far south, if you know what I mean. And his teammate said, actually, it's funny you say that, because I reckon we need to head a bit more south. I think we're going too far west. They had a bit of a discussion about it, and in the end, they agreed to disagree. He had come out for his shift, rode due west. His teammate had come out, rode due south. Excuse me. Due west, due south, and they did that for about 2 days, would you believe, going, you know, not very fast, in the right direction. And, of course, they were well back in the fleet. That's not working together as a team. Often asked, how'd you go to the toilet? It was a bucket and chuck it, and it was a very efficient flushing mechanism. If you want to check this out, this is the technique. It was very effective. Oh, damn. Prince Andrew came out from the UK for the awards ceremony, gave us a piece of wood with a turtle on it. Absolute choice, bro. Awesome, mate. And he also gave us a couple of trophies, and there was no prize money in the race, and it wasn't about prize money. It was about making the decision. It was about committing to it. It was about getting the team around you to support you to the goal. And it was about just having a go. And our team, I should say, was 100 strong, from friends, family, advisors, sponsors, boat builders, just getting out there. One of the things I discovered, though, mid-Atlantic, was the importance of, under challenging times, how you respond to those challenges. And, in fact, one thing I really discovered with real acuteness was stuff that hadn't really been dealt with in my family's past.
On the afternoon of the 13th, we'd thought that we could hear a boat engine at intervals throughout the afternoon, but we couldn't be sure. And suddenly a boat began to close in on us very quickly. I was about to go up on deck when the boat opened fire and sent some shots over the mast.
I am deeply honoured and moved to be here today, given the opportunity to speak. I realise that this is a privilege made available to a few, especially compared to the numbers of families that suffered under the Khmer Rouge regime. I arrived in Cambodia last week. Last Thursday, 13th of August, was coincidentally 31 years to the day that my brother, Kerry Hamill, first set foot on Cambodian soil. This is the story of an innocent man brought to his knees and killed in the prime of his life. My eldest brother, Kerry, at the age of 27, in 1978, was having his adventures. And he was sailing the seas, the seven seas, and had been travelling for nearly a year at the time, and on a yacht, his yacht, and he was getting by doing paid charter trips day trips, weekend trips, up to 2 weeks at a time. I met a couple of English guys who travelled with Kerry for 2 weeks, and they had the adventure of a lifetime with Kerry, and he was having an adventure of his lifetime. On his last fateful charter voyage from Singapore to Bangkok, they got blown off course into Cambodian waters, took shelter behind an island called Koh Tang, about 50 kilometres offshore, no bigger than Rangitoto. On the other side of that island was a Khmer Rouge naval gun base. That evening they were attacked by a gunboat. Kerry's friend, a Canadian, Stuart Glass, was shot and killed at that time. And my brother with the charter, an Englishman, John Dewhurst, were taken back to Toosling Prison in the capital, Phnom Penh, where they were tortured for 2 months, forced to sign confessions to being CIA, and were then executed. When I was at sea, I grieved for my bro, mid-Atlantic. I grieved for Kerry every day, rowing solo on the oars or in the cabin alone while full rowed. I grieved for Kerry acutely, like I had just heard the news. And I realised I had to do something sometime to honour his memory, his legacy. At that time, I didn't know how that would look. The man who changed his fate, Pol Pot, April 17, 1975, the Khmer Rouge came into power, swept into the streets of Phnom Penh, forced 2 million plus dwellers into the countryside. Those who resisted were killed. Anyone who was had political affiliations to the former government were killed. Anyone who was highly educated, the same deal. The rest were basically sent out into the country to grow rice. And the city was left as basically a desert town. One of the few places that remained operational was this prison, converted from a high school into a torture camp, operated by a guy called Doik, Comrade Doik, lovely chap, created what we call the killing fields on the outskirts of Phnom Penh. The process of going into the prison, prisoners were brought into the compound from all around the country, travelling in cattle trucks, tied together by ropes or chain, neck to neck, handcuffed and blindfolded as well. They were brought into the prison, their blindfold was removed, a number was tagged to their clothing, and their photograph was taken. And it didn't matter what age they were, it didn't matter what gender they were, it didn't matter if they're a child. Once that photograph was taken, their fate was sealed. It didn't matter if they're a baby of a suspected enemy of the state. And 99.9% of those victims were innocent. The city, the country became a paranoid, the regime started eating itself alive with paranoia. This kid would be at the same age as my eldest boy, about with chain padlock around his neck, number tagged to his clothing. This kid didn't have any clothing on, so he pinned the number to his chest. Somewhere between 15 and 30,000 people went through that facility, and they all met the same fate. In my family's situation, we had no idea what had happened to Kerry. He just went missing. Letters was the staple, and Kerry wrote the most beautiful letters that we lived vicariously by. They stopped. 16 months went by until we heard about it in the media, about his capture, incarceration, torture, and confession. And this confession's an extraordinary document. What Kerry did, to give some semblance of credibility to it, he mixed fact with fiction, and he talked about growing up in Whakatane, New Zealand, and having adventures with his family, and he converted those into CIA training operations. That confession is still in the prison grounds today.
There was a general culture at the prison that whenever somebody walked into it, they became the walking dead. When that becomes a reality is once you have signed your confession, it just has to be extracted. And what did they do to my brother to get that confession?
What Kerry did to tell his story was he used humour and irony to tell that story quite extraordinarily. This is it. This is Kerry's confession, taken under duress. And I guess this is the Khmer version.
I from New Zealand, and I am the CIA. I hereby to testify have used the modern equipment of Mary Mary.
Mary Mary is a, I think it was a gas-fired power station, or maybe a coal-fired power station. He's just, you know, there's a lot of humour here, and can you believe he's just trying to have some fun.
I enrolled in the Psychology for Intelligence Officers course. This was taught by an American CIA intelligence officer, Major Roos. And Roos, of course, being a con. A course on covers for intelligence officers was given by Colonel Sanders, which is obviously under duress. Kerry was retaining some sort of sense of humour.
He also managed to communicate, talking about how he was being trained up, actually how he was being treated in the prison.
We were taught interrogation techniques such as confusion of the prisoner's time and space and orientation, the effects of changes in attitude towards the prisoner, lack of sleep, pain, etc. And you could interpret that that's what he was experiencing at that time.
He also managed to send coded messages that only our family would decipher. The public speaking course was compulsory for all the second year students. This was taught by Mr. S. Tarr of the Carnegie Institute. Tarr was the head of the CIA office in Hamilton. He held the rank of captain. And S. Tarr, of course, is my mum, Esther. Yeah, and as I said, she was a lovely speaker, and she had this lovely Irish lilt that, it was a message to my mum. It was a message to my mum. You know, that's the wrong slide. Okay, there's a, I take so much inspiration from that confession. You know, Lemon, to use humour in that hellhole, you know, who knows what he was going through at that time. And, you know, Colonel Sanders was a busy bloke back in the 70s, setting up a KFC empire, training my bro to be CIA. And just extraordinary, just extraordinary. You know, I don't know if you've read Viktor Frankl's book, Man's Search for Meaning, a survivor from Nazi Germany's Auschwitz. And he talked about not all the prisoners were taken straight to the gas chambers. The stronger were used as slave labour. And he observed his fellow inmates, the ones who survived, if they were not murdered, the ones who survived were those who retained a sense of hope, a sense of belief. Absolutely critical. And he said he saw the ones that lost that sense of hope, they see it in their eyes, and within 24 hours they perished. They lost the will. Critical. A sense of hope and belief. And he wrote in his book, and I haven't got the quote here, it was supposed to be up on here, but it was an amazing quote that says, it says something like, where everything has been taken away from you, when all sense of individualism and humanity has been taken away from you, you have one choice to make, and that is how you respond to your situation. How you respond to your situation. And every day we are challenged in many different ways to respond to situations. Given minor examples being the day-to-day occurrences that occur. Someone cuts you off at the green light. The kid smashes up the car, takes your keys and dings your car. Or any random small occurrence. And every day we are being challenged, aren't we, how we respond to those situations. And if we can respond and take a deep breath, take a step back, count to 10 if you have to, before you give a measured, remove the emotion as much as possible, practical, rational response. It could, when the big things happen, and we all know the big things happen, hopefully change your life and how you respond to those situations. 9 months after we heard the news about Kerry was missing for 16 months, remember? 9 months after we heard the news, my second eldest brother, John, sent a photo, took his life. He didn't take the step back that, we would have hoped. And my parents suffered greatly. And the reason I'm talking about this stuff is because the first time, 30 years, 2 to 3 million lives lost, the first person to be brought to any sort of justice was that charming chap I introduced you to, who ran the prison, Comrade Doig. And he was the at the War Crimes Tribunal, and I had the incredible privilege of being invited to testify in the War Crimes Tribunal and face Duyk, and that was interesting. And and also I took the step of helping produce a film with an amazing group of people called Brother Number One, an extraordinary film, just telling the story, the whole story of the genocide, the forgotten genocide in some ways, through my brother's story in my eyes. And also the step of talking about it, because it's kind of important, it's the hardest step of all. Because if I had 7, 8, 9 years ago, when I started working on this project, I'd put that photo up to a random sampling of New Zealanders, I'd get a detailed, lengthy, and informed answer, right? And if I'd put this photo up, many would not have known who that was. And that's still true today, even though the court cases raised the profile somewhat. And I'll give you an example. We took the film around the world. Film festivals went all over the place. And one time I went over there to introduce the film in London and do a Q&A afterwards. On the tube to the cinema, I got talking to a young lady, and I asked her, tell me, what do you know about Pol Pot? And she thought for a moment and said, oh, yeah, no, that's that... that guy who won Britain's Got Talent contest, the opera singer guy, eh? Yeah. I said, no, that's Paul Potts. that's this fella here. Different ball game. Different ball game altogether. But it's a reality of today, and it's still, it's one of those things, you know. And I have to say, this is more regional and recent history, and yet it's kind of not really, and, you know, we talk about it in the hope that we can minimise these things happening again. One of the biggest things I've learned in this whole journey to Cambodia is the dealing with grief. Dealing with grief, the importance of symbolism and ceremony and dealing with grief. I think that's one of the biggest things I've taken away from this. And if you ever see the film, I did something very ceremonial that I thought would have been cheesy if someone had described it to me. But it was very powerful for me personally. And I think in the film, I think it works too. But the fact is, it's, you know, there are so many things we can do, and we all have grief. We know that, to help. And I'll give you an example of another thing I did. If you see the film, I won't say what I did there. But something that wasn't in the film was I got some a glass jar, I got some water from the sea outside our near where we live in Whakatane. Got some river water as well. Got some sand from the beaches we played on. Soil from the backyard of our house that we all grew up at, and I took that to Cambodia with me, went to the prison grounds, had it blessed by a Buddhist monk, and I sprinkled some of those remains around the prison grounds, and also went out into the streets to an area where I think Kerry's remains were, and continued the ceremony. And I talked, I spoke, and I think the power of speaking actually adds something, I don't know, and I'm just telling you what I did, and because we all have grief in our lives. And I think Māori, Pacific Islanders do it way better than we do. I used to go into marae, you know, here we go again, you know, half an hour later. And I remember one, there was about half a dozen wahine at the back of the marae, wailing, remembering their lost loved ones. And I get that now. I think, and you know, it's cool. I think we have a lot to learn from other cultures. Can you imagine being my parents, being, you know, having lost two children, pretty tragic circumstances, then a third son says, I want to row across the Atlantic Ocean. You know, I came back from the Olympics absolutely fire in the belly. I've got to do this race, right? And it seemed so right, because partly because of the connection, I think, with my brother and the ocean and the water, you know, all that stuff. I don't know, but it was so perfect. I couldn't understand why no one else really got it. And I was beavering away, but I couldn't tell Mum and Dad what I was doing. Because it was just, you know, obviously. And it took me a month. The media were getting hold of it, right? The media were getting hold of it. Jeez. Peter Montgomery on the phone to Dad, blah, 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 blah. A few questions. Speak to Mum briefly. Rung off. Thought, that went okay. Could have been worse. Half an hour later, the phone rings. It's Mum. I thought, here we go. You know what she says? She says, son, you go for it. She said, this could be the making of you. Clearly, she didn't think I'd made anything in my life at all at that time. Apparently the Olympics wasn't good enough for her. But wasn't that the most beautiful, you know, loving and courageous gesture, you know, in that context, and forever, you know, thankful for that, for my mother and my father. God bless them. And God rest their souls. How beautiful. These are my three boys. And, you know, they're climbing the tree. They are climbing the tree. It's a very metaphorical climbing the tree photo. Yeah, we live in a world of responsibility, accountability, and it's great, but man, does it get over the top, doesn't it? You know, our role as parents, as caregivers, is to give our children the skills to climb their tree, whatever that is, however that looks. And, you know, look out for the dead leaves. Don't avoid that branch if you can. If you have to, go close to the trunk. You know, all simple, but just giving the skills. And obviously try and be there to catch them if they fall out, but if you don't, then try and scrape up the pieces afterwards as best we can. But we have to let them go. And it's the same for us, isn't it? We all have our own tree to climb as well. And some trees may be pretty daunting, but if we really want to climb them, we just have to learn how to climb them and upskill ourselves to do the job. Part of what I do now is help others to climb their tree or have their adventures, and I'll talk briefly. I'm really unsure of time. Sorry, Joan. Another 5 minutes or so? Half an hour. I've got half an hour up my sleeve. Holy heck. Oh, 1964 was very good. Oh, fantastic. 5 minutes. 5, 7 minutes. Just talk briefly about this guy here in the funny hat, Kevin Bigger. Clever guy, super brain. High-powered job, corporate, doing big hours, earning huge money, had an apartment in Ponsonby overlooking Auckland Harbour Bridge, beautiful girlfriend, his life was sorted. And he had what he later called was a quarter-life crisis, where he felt like all his choices had been kind of taken away from him, the edginess had gone a little bit, and it was all too easy, it was all too mapped out, and he freaked out, quit his job, dumped his girlfriend, sold his apartment, shifted back in with his mum. Mate, that's a crisis of everything, he asked me. And he said to his mum, I'm going to row across the Atlantic Ocean. Now, his mother, God bless her, spat the dummy, as my mum should have, and could have. And they had a bit of a barney about this concept, and in the end, they couldn't agree yet. And in the end, they actually agreed to go to arbitration, seriously, on this very important matter. And the biggest court in the land, and that day was a TV show called How's Life, some of you may remember, fronted by the late, beautiful Charlotte Dawson. People would write in their problems, panel of experts and celebrities would discuss it 5 minutes, everyone go away happy. He said, Mum, write into How's Life, ask him what I should do. If they say I should go, I'll go. If they say I shouldn't, I won't. This is what they did say.
Our next letter is from a mother who's worried because her son's determined to paddle his own canoe. God bless him. Dear How's Life, my 33-year-old son has a master's degree and a successful business career. He threw it in to go travelling and now wants to compete in the transatlantic rowing race next year. This will take up all his time and savings. When it's over, he'll be 35, broke, jobless, and probably still living at home with me. I think he should be building his career. How can I make him see reason? Concerned mother by email. Marcus, what does he do? Fulfill his ambitions?
You just imagine if we were on the show 50 years ago on the radiogram, you know, Dear How's Life, my son wants to throw in his beekeeping practice to climb Mount Everest, you know? Can anyone here see any problem at all?
None.
Okay, Marcus, we've got a gay issue coming up soon, so you might want to belt up until that one's on.
Goodness gracious.
Yeah, I think she should be celebrating that this guy's busting
exactly.
Free. I mean, how boring life would be if he just keeps going the way he is? 35, I don't know about your fella's culture, but mine is, that's young.
Yeah. Of course he's seeing reason, he's seeing it right. He's following his heart, he's following his passion.
Spirit.
Yeah, the adventuresome spirit of it all. You're dead right, Marcus, and I think that she's got the problem with this. I think he's right on track as far as I'm concerned.
I think she's got a very bad attitude, this concerned mother. I'm concerned about concerned mother, quite frankly. She's got a son here who can take her for a row of an afternoon, and, you know, the guy's only 33, his whole life's ahead of him.
He sounds fantastic.
Sort of got stuck into mum there, so
the computer.
Even though it's go the rowing, go for it, do what you want, you've still got to talk to your mum.
Yeah, wasn't that great? Yeah, we tuned in that evening, and watched it, and I saw it was a panel of all blokes. I thought, you beauty, it's got to be a guy, for sure. And they said all the right things, didn't they? But I thought Marcus Lush was the most poetic or whatever, with his comment, you know, you imagine 50 years ago on the radiogram, dear How's Life, my son wants to throw in his beekeeping practice to climb Mount Everest. And doesn't that say it all about anything that is a little bit challenging, a little bit impossible, that it is actually possible? And you imagine being Ed back in those days and what people were perhaps saying, hopefully under their breath, but not to him, you know, he can't do that. He'll never do it. He'll kill him for sure. And what do you reckon if any of that negative sentiment had infiltrated Sir Edmund's thinking at that time? Would he have done it? Absolutely not. You know, the first major hurdle, I knew it. I was right. It's like that Henry Ford saying, isn't it? If you think you can, you're right. If you think you can't, you're right. So true. So true. An amazing man, an icon. And how did Ed and Tenzing Norgay climb Mount Everest? They climbed it one step at a time. Really simple analogy for life. And these two guys rode across the Atlantic Ocean one stroke at a time. And I had a huge empathy for them coming into Barbados. They won. They defended the title for New Zealand. And I had a huge empathy for these two as they came into Barbados. And I thought, I'll do something special for them. So I rang Miss Barbados and invited her to come along to the finish line. She had just won the beauty pageant. And she was awesome, man. She was such a lot of fun and great. She's right into it. And, mate, what a unit, I tell you. She was very impressive. Very impressive lady. She was about 6'4" and she was on about 3-inch stilettos. And Jamie's a big unit, the other rower, she towered over him. And he thought it was absolutely marvellous right up until...
There's 6 weeks at sea.
I can't you?
I arrived in Barbados and realised after... we got told after an hour that being kissed by what I thought was a 6'6" woman was actually a man.
Oh, bad Rob, bad Rob. Yeah, there she was there. She was the diva of Barbados, and that's the giveaway there, actually. She was the diva of Barbados. She had just won the diva competition, and she was well-known, well-liked, and everyone knew her, and she was great fun, and right into it. And Kevin picked up on it real quick. I said, yeah, nice one, Hamill. Yeah, good one, mate. And Jamie was like, Hamill, you beauty! It was marvellous. So these two went on to do another adventure. A few years back, they walked to the South Pole. And I love this photo, training, dragging tyres around the streets of Auckland and Wellington. Keep moving! And I think that's another great thing in life. We've got to keep moving, don't we? Keep exercising, just keep moving. It's really important. Lovely story. Jamie was based in Wellington, been out for about 8 hours up in the hills, came back into the city, came up to a light, red lights. Street lights could turn red, he pulled to a halt. An old HQ Holden idled up alongside him. Window winds down, massive arm falls out the side. Bro, what you doing? He said, oh mate, off to the South Pole. Bro, you're going the wrong way. So they took a GPS and compass and they found their way to the South Pole. And that is the South Pole, there it is there. That's a little barbershop, that's it, that's the South Pole. Pretty cool. Wrote a book about our adventures called The Naked Rower. So called because I can't cook, in case you're wondering. And younger people won't get that joke, that's okay. And by some strange coincidence, I happen to have some copies of the book here today, ladies and gentlemen. Normally $29.95, $30 for you guys. Jane's negotiating. That's right. So, pardon? Absolutely. Absolutely. Oh, that's a great idea. Yeah, absolutely. And we've got $35. Go, Jane. I love it. Entrepreneurship. $50 going to the desk. And look, I realise you may not have cash, so we can just give you your contacts and I'll send you my account details later. You can take it away. We have the film as well, the DVD here, and that's the same price, or $50 for the two. Last boat to finish the first ever rowing race across an ocean was a mother and her son, would you believe, did this race. And mum was 53 years old. She actually had a birthday at sea. Son was 23 years old. And they spent Christmas at sea, these two. They spent 101 days stuck on that little boat together. And they very appropriately called their boat Carpe Diem, translated from Latin, of course, means seize the day. Seize the day. The most appropriately named boat in the fleet. And you know, just a wonderful example of just what is possible if you give it a nudge, give it a go. And they, you know, this race, this is slightly contradictory. It wasn't about winning. Sure, it was for us, but actually it really wasn't about winning. It was about, because there's only going to be one winner, 30 entries. And it was actually about pushing your own personal boundaries outside the comfort zone, wasn't it? And these two represented that perfectly. You know, one of the things, like, yeah, I guess that gets me about, and this is rampant in schools and in general life, actually, is the desire to compare each other. To compare each other constantly with exams, with tests, where you sit relative to Johnny down the road. And Mum saying, why can't you be like Johnny down the road? Why can't you jump higher than that? You know, all this stuff. It's effectively this comparing constantly, competitiveness constantly. I know that sounds ironic coming from me because I'm highly competitive. But the moment you compare yourself legitimately with someone else, I'll always find someone better than me out there. Everyone's got someone better than themselves out there. If you want to undermine a kid's self-esteem, go comparing them to somebody else down the street straight away. Can you imagine if Jan and Dan, these two, compared themselves with us? There's no way. It's a ridiculous comparison. You know, the only person you can compare yourself with is the person you were yesterday. Isn't that true? And you hope that you're a better person today through your upskilling or your discovery or you made a hash of this and you, whatever, you fell over, you got back up again today, you're going to have another go. That is the only person that we should be comparing ourselves with. And to do that, you've got to seize the day and get out there and get amongst it. Thanks very much. Cheers.
Thank you very much. Rob, what's your name? What was that? Oh, Rob Waddell, thank you. Thank you for a wonderful, inspiring talk on and encouraging us to pursue our dreams and keep our hopes alive. I'm going to take note. I'm going to ring my sons at morning tea time. I'm going to say, yes, you can do it. Anything you want to do, yes, go for it. But I do not want to spend 100 days in a boat with my youngest son. He's a monosyllabic grunter at the best of times, and I do not think I would cope in 100 days of silence with him. Thank you. It's been amazing to have you, but I'm sure there are people that would like to comment or ask you questions. So do we have any questions? We've got a couple of mics. Yep. Melissa.
Hi, Rob. I was just wondering, when you started that race and took the different direction, how many hours or days was it before there were no other boats in sight?
Yeah, so, within hours, actually. In fact, there was one boat that was reasonably... In fact, there was one other boat in the fleet who we rated as the most competitive because they were the only crew that had a rowing background. It turned out we heard that they pulled out the next day. They got seasick. And they stayed with us for about an hour and then drifted off, but within probably 3 hours perhaps, that was it. Everyone just amazing.
So no one was there?
3 or 4
hours. You didn't see anybody for the rest of the time?
The next morning we saw one boat, and we thought we saw one boat in the distance, but that was it, yeah. Yeah. I should say, I'll tell you a little story around that I didn't, a bit more detail around that story. You know, when that water maker failed, we changed our course. There's one more island on the last island called Hiero, and we figured we were heading, God, if I showed you the map, but anyway. I can do this. Watch this. I'm going to go back here, and we're just going to whiz back to the start. Life's an adventure. And here's that map. Now, I'm going to show you the island. It might have been that one or this one. It must have been this island here. We were heading down more in this direction this way. And then we realized, well, maybe if we just get across, because we'd be fighting the seas, but we'd go across the seas and try and get to that last island. And there we might be able to take shelter, because it was rough as guts, it really was. We knew we couldn't fix the thing there. Because we had to make some tough decisions. Do we try and turn back and get to the start line, repair the water maker, and then start the race again? You know, it might be a day or two behind everyone, but just, you know, or try and fix this thing and find out if we can fix it. If we can't, we're going to definitely have to go back. Do you know what I mean? We thought we'd take that option. So we're going across these seas, and that was the reason that night we were exposed to being capsized. It was really dangerous. And that's how we broke the oar. We did get to the island. We did repair this thing. And actually, sorry, I should say too, that was when we saw, because we're going across the seas, we would have been way out in front by several miles. But going across, we did potentially see that little boat. And we got to the island, fixed the water maker, it was okay, it was an electrical fault, and got going again. And so we had figured going across the seas, and I don't know, it was a couple of hours mucking around with the machine, got going. We figured we'd lost probably in real terms 4 or 5 hours of real on our course time. Later that second day, so the race was about, I don't know, 36 hours old, we saw there was a support ship, the mothership. It was a 70-foot yacht that was shadowing the fleet across the Atlantic. It was the only boat it was the only time we saw them. And they informed us that we were coming fourth. And we're going, what? You can't be serious. We've lost so much water maker, blah, blah, blah. No, we've just come back through the first three. We're coming back through the fleet. We thought we'd be 20th or last, probably, you know. We're in fourth place. And that was a real confirmation for us that we knew, you know, we are fast compared to the fleet, that is, relative to the fleet. And it gave us great sense of, you know, purpose to just, we knew if we just stuck with our regime, two on, two off, around the clock, you know, that was, yeah. So it was a pretty, you know, it was a disaster, but actually it was a good thing too, because to really know that comparison, especially not having that communications. And that was the thing we stuck to that helped keep the belief, I guess. Yeah. Any other questions? Yeah.
Just with the grieving of your brother during that time, was your teammate concerned that things weren't going to go well if you were visibly grieving?
He had no idea. He had no idea. Yeah. No, it was all very silent, blubbering. It was really acute. Yeah. But it was alone. Yeah. No, he had no idea. Never talked about it afterwards either. Yeah. Right. And never got to talk about it, because I don't know if you know the story, but a year after the race, Phil was killed in an airplane crash. He was a hobby pilot. And, one of these things we never got to talk about, which was a shame, really. I mean, he would have really got into this film. He would have been quite, yeah.
Hi, thank you very much. That's awesome. But I was just wondering, you didn't have kids when you did this, did you? This is a while ago. And what about a wife?
No, I didn't have kids. But there were people who, you know, obviously had kids who were doing the race. And there have been several races since who, you know, in fact, there's been a father-son do the race. I'd love to do the race with my boys. No, I had a girlfriend, but
That's cool, and it's great what you said about your mum. I mean, that's amazing, because, of course, as a mother, you just want to protect your kids, but really we should all live by her example. I mean, yeah, it's been awesome. Thank you very much.
Isn't that amazing? Thank you. That's lovely to hear. And it's, just to add to just to give you a real perspective, I'm sure you understand, but I guess just imagine back in that time, this is in the late 70s when this was all happening, and there was no support. You know, the support systems just were not there. And this is a little town, Whakatane village, you know, everyone knew everyone. Our family and friends, yeah, to a degree, you know, and remember suicide back then too. There's a real stigma attached to that. So all bad parents, you know, all that stuff. And, you know, they were so strong. And I know a lot of you, your situations, you have to be strong too. It's so tough. And, but it's so rewarding too. Because of their strength, they got such reward from, you know, from their choices and their decisions, you know. It's really cool. It's a great, you know, yeah. And, kids of my own now, I've got more empathy for what their situation was. So it's pretty cool. Pretty beautiful.
Are you still rowing, or what do you do for the thrills nowadays?
Am I still rowing? So no, I gave up rowing many years ago, about a decade ago, but now I have just started again, would you believe? Stupid as a stupid does. And because the World Masters Games are here, of course, so of course I've got to have another crack. It's just stupid. I tell you, this last month I've been through so much pain and discomfort. Oh, and just thinking, why? Anyway, so I'm not ready for it, but I'm having a go in a couple of weeks' time at Karapiro. And I'm doing a few different events with some friends and doing the single. The single scull is the most exposed event you can do, right? You're putting yourself out there. And I'm doing the single, and I know I'm not ready, and I'm just dreading the fact that I'll probably get my bum handed to me on a plate. Is that, what is it? Yeah, on a plate. And I'm going to try my best not to have that happen, but I know I'm not ready for it, so I probably will. But it's a great sport. Rowing's a fantastic sport. You know, it's good for, obviously physically, it's good for your health and that, but it's a, and the risk injury of, injury of risks is, is very low. You know, there's relative to a lot of other sports. It's pretty neat, and it just extremely challenges all parts of your body to work. And I've really rediscovered that recently. And great friends, great people too. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Rob. It's been fantastic to hear you speak. Good luck in
Karapiro.
Don't forget
Thanks
to wear
much.
Your rowing gear.
We didn't talk about naked rowing, did I?
Gave you enough hints.
I know. I didn't talk about it. It was actually,
Now, please join me in thanking Rob.
Thank you.